Hello, I'm Myriam. I'm teaching at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro at the Bachelor Undergraduate in Gastronomy. And this work was done with my partner, my colleague Marcella Sulis, and she's a gastronomer and she's specialized in sweet meat and Brazilian sweet culture. She is in the kitchen, she's a chef, and I'm PhD in social memory, so I am a theory teacher, and I'm so sorry, my English is not so good, so I'm very nervous about it. Okay, what we have done here, actually I'm a vegetarian, and it was very hard to work with this subject, the Mocotó. Mocotó is marrow, and it's done by the Oxford, and the bovine cattle was brought to Brazil by the Portuguese and the Dutch during the colonization. We didn't have bovine, and it became a national dish, and not the mocotó, but the cattle. We just eat meat of bovine and chicken, and we don't mix very much the meat we had before with the ancients. But the name mocotó is Tupi Guarani, which is indigenous language, mocotok, and there was a priest, a Jesuit, who found a recipe. He wrote about the recipe that the indigenous people of Bahia, which is a state in the middle of the huge country, where the Indians were cooking capybara, which is a Brazilian native animal, food, and they used to make the jelly about it. But, I mean, this is the ambiguity, a lot of ambiguity about this subject, just because all the Indians and Afro-descendant in Brazil, we have a very hierarchical society. Therefore, all the Occidental way of eating was brought by the Portuguese, and it became like the way everybody eats. Therefore, the name mocotó was used to name the part of the ox food, but nobody talks about the indigenous or even the Afro-descendant transmission of this part of the ox feed. Well, what you see here is a image of a boy opening his shirt and like Superman, and he's saying mocotó is very good for your health, for children grows. This is an image about maybe the end of the 70s or beginning of 80s, brought by the television. And television in Brazil was a sort of our very bad modernity, because it linked the whole country all together, because the country is huge, and we have this global television and this horrible television anyway, but it's a mass television, and they had the permission to make communication all around Brazil. So therefore, Brazilian idea of nationality comes a lot through the television media. It's completely different from what you had here in Europe. It was done at the end of 18 and in the 19th century. And so we had this industrialization of food culture through the television and advertisement and publicity, especially through 50s, 60s, and 70s. And since then, Mocotó was linked to children's roles because it was thought that Mocotó had the nutrients and it was a good food for children. So all the children in Brazil ate Mocotó, but not anymore. And why not? Because we are now entering these new agendas about healthy and about vegetarian and not liking eating meat. And for example, many people now are discovering through social networks like Facebook, etc., that Mocotó jam, which is supposed to be a tenderness and motherhood, affective food for children, is made of ox feet. Therefore, people will say, oh my God, I cannot eat this anymore. That's why we're talking about this mixture of offal, because the ox food was is not a very nice part of the cattle, and the gastronomy culture in Brazil, we don't use Mocotó very much at by the elite because it's low value and it's a spare part of the ox, and it's despised as something very bad. So it's used for cosmetic industry and for the mass production of jellies and gelatin and Mocotó jelly, okay? Okay. Well, this is the abstract. Maybe it's the only part I can read because I was told not to read, and I'm kind of very nervous about this. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
And you know, it's great.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Then that's. This abstract, we say that Mocotó, made of cooked ox food, a bovine part of consumption culturally rejected by the Brazilian gastronomy, the geleia de Mocotó, geleia is jam, né, is, however, a very popular sweet cooking and recommended for infants' nourishment. In this sense, this jam has become an aliment linked to the affective memory of many Brazilians who ate it during childhood. Nowadays, due to new alimentary agendas that restrict the use of sugar or reject the consumption of animal food, this jam is very seldom prepared as a craftsman product, because it used to be made by the Afro-dancer and the Afro-Brazilians, and also craftsmen that confectionaries. But now we don't find it anymore. A study of these agendas brings to light social, cultural, and historical factors that are the basis of this jam preparation, which is the sugar, nutrient associated with the foundation of Brazil. Sugar is, we have a very important sociologist called Gilberto Freire, and he used to call Brazil as the sugar civilization. And the bovine waste that was the origin of enslaved Afro-descendant cookings, because this Afro-descendant, they were enslaved and they would eat what the Portuguese wouldn't eat. Therefore, they prepared all the food with these spare parts. With a view to discuss more historical and social sources, as well as to present manufacture of the geleia de Mocotó, this article aims at showing its cultural importance in Brazil, restoring it as a culinary technique of the Brazilian confectionery art. Okay, let's move now. Here. Okay. Here we have this picture, well, actually a painting of the sugarcane
harvest,
exactly, at the beginning of the colonization of the country. And here you have a mill of sugarcane. The first sugarcane mills and harvests, they were built at the north of Brazil, at Pernambuco, and the Dutch went there, and they also kind of robbed the method of refining sugar. And although the Portuguese were very rich about selling sugar, and after a while, about the 17th century, we could not compete with the Dutch and the English with production of sugar. And then we moved our Brazilian cycle, economical cycle, for the mining of gold. And then we moved it to the inland, the state of Minas Gerais. Minas means mines. And the slaves that were in the north of the country, they were sold or they immigrate to this state. And then we have a new cycle. And after that, maybe during that, it was during that because the gold would come from Minas Gerais, the state, to Rio de Janeiro, and then would embark to Europe. And then Rio de Janeiro became the capital of the country at that time. And before talking about this cycle, what we have is that the slaves from Afro descendant, they would prepare with this spare rough and brown sugar the very beginning of our cachaça, which is a national distilled drink. You must know or have heard about it. And then they would prepare the dish Mocotó at the top, because this is a broth, and the broth of Mocotó was brought from Portugal at the beginning of the colonization, and they used to cook this broth in Portugal, in the region of Ribatejo, which is the Tagus River region, kind of a province somewhere there. And they used to cook this with chickpeas. And in Brazil, it was absorbed as without the chickpeas, because we didn't have in the north of Brazil and in the very south. So there is a kind of fight in between the north and the south, saying, oh, this is our national regional dish. But I mean, we don't care because we are not from any of those. And they used to use the spare of ox and also pigs, is Afro-descendant. They would create our national dish, which means feijoada, which is done with the black beans, liver beans, right? And all this, you can see parts of the meats. It's still today, we have this, some people don't eat with the offal, with the ear and nose, and it's there, and I don't like it myself, but we can have this this feijoada with just kind of luxury parts of the pig or the ox. Okay. Then for the jelly, we have this addition of culture of sugar. And you see the ox feet, it's rarely sold at the butchery because it's very ugly and people really reject it. And the sugar, it's a very, we have this culture of sugar which is very deepened into Brazilian way of loving food. So we don't add sugar like in India. You have this mixture of sugar and salt. But in Brazil, no, we have sugar very separated. But we love sugar, and we think this is food of mother. And now it's changing, and because of this, oh, you cannot eat sugar because sugar is horrible. We had this English chef going there, and Jamie Oliver. Jamie Oliver went to Brazil, and he was trying a very, very traditional Brazilian sweet, which is called a brigadeiro. And he said, this is a junk. And it was kind of a fever at the internet. Everybody saying he was horrible. He was, but I mean, he was just saying sugar was not good. But people could not understand very well what he was saying anyway. But okay. Okay. After the cycle then of sugarcane, we went to the cycle of the gold, as we told you, and then the slaves went to Rio de Janeiro, and we have a very weird tradition because we didn't have this privacy culture, social culture in Brazil, like public and private culture, as you had here as an urban society in Europe. England was the first, and we had this mixture of inside and out culture, and we didn't have glasses, nor we didn't have iron, and all the roads and the houses, they used to have this kind of opening door or opening window, and actually this is a very poetic thing because we have very good writers like Machado de Assis, who is the a very important novelist in Brazil, and he was saying this was magical because the air, Brazil is very hot, the air was coming through but not the sun, and so people were watching through this, we call it, this is a Moroccan and tradition that came to Portugal, it was brought to Brazil, and so you had this fence. And the light was going through, and the black people, they were slaves, they could maybe buy their freedom also by selling food, and so they would bring food in and out the houses. And then you have this, you can see these pictures, this was painted by a French painter Debré, who was brought to Brazil by the King John the Sixth, and he brought a mission of French artists to touch Brazil, how to make art, because they thought we couldn't make art. But this is Brazilian, is always like that. We always think we don't know anything in it, and but. It was very good because his painting is really wonderful, and he was picturing the city of Rio de Janeiro at the end of 18th to the 19th century. So he pictured this black women selling in the trays and the food, and most of this food was mixed with sugar because sugar would prevent the food of being spoiled. Therefore, the black descendant, the now Brazilian Afro Brazilians, they were the ones that transmitted their tradition of Mocotó jelly and Mocotó broth to our day. So we owe to them this tradition.
Okay. Free.
Well, it's mixed. Some were enslaved, and they would maybe prepare the sweets and the delicacies at home, and would sell and bring money to the owner. And others, no. The others, they would we would call in Portuguese escravos de ganho, which is slaves that earn money. Or very bad translation, in a way. Yeah, but okay. Okay. I tried to find, to show you a little bit of the things they were selling at the roads with that trail. Of course, it's not the same, but special, the Mocotó broth, they would sell, the vatapá, which is a spicy dish of shrimp, coconut milk, peanuts, and palm oil. Pamonha, which is made of maize paste and rolled in maize rusks. The canjica, also made by grated maize, coconut milk, and sugar. Acaçá, which is a thick mush made from grated white corn wrapped in banana leaves. And abará, which is mashed, de-skinned, kidded beans with sugar, wrapping with moist paste and banana leaves. We are trying to recall these dishes now because it's very Brazilian culture and they are actually very good. But still we are working with this patrimonial of culinary in Brazil. But these were the things they were selling their trails. And we don't have any document at, up to now we could find, me and Marcella, that would tell that these people would have a tray with Mocotó jam. But we believe so because a lot of these dishes were made with sugar. Therefore, we think that Mocotó jelly was sold at the tray. I have just 5 minutes. Oh my God. Okay. I run. Okay. This is also what people were selling at the road. Okay. You have the coconut rice, corn flour mush, which is angur. It's very good. And a sort of rice sponge cake. It's not the same. This is a very Portuguese recipe mixed with the Afro-Brazilians. And this is a very beautiful roleta de cana made of sugar cane. And rebuçados means candies, just the sugar done like little candies. Very beautiful. They were selling this on the trail as well. I have to hurry. Sorry. Okay. We have this 19th century Rio de Janeiro with urban, very a lot of changings, and as you see, it's just like Paris. So we were imitating Paris, and from there we have another cycle because the mines and the gold were going down, and now we have the coffee cycle. And from the coffee cycle, we developed this very interesting sort of confectionery in the middle of the town of Rio. This one is the most famous, called Colombo. And it sells like tea and lunch and breakfast, very different food. But the secret of this confectionery was exactly the mixture of some food prepared like sweet meats from Portugal and from Brazil. And one of those was the Mocotó jelly. And this made a nut grade from this Mocotó jelly experimentation of the popular people at the road for the middle class and the elite of Rio de Janeiro. Therefore, the jelly survived in a different manner. And actually, it was kind of, as you see here, Colombo has this Mocotó glass specially made from them. And it was used of people collecting the glass at home as kind of a souvenir. They went to Colombo to have the Mocotó jelly. But at the same time, Colombo, at the beginning of the 20th century, they went bankrupt. And that a Dutch company called Alisco, Industrial Alimentary Company, bought the Colombo confectionery, and they start producing the Mocotó as industrialized, okay? Well, then we have a shift again, because in the 70s we had this all this new urban modification of the urban area of Rio and all the town, and we stupidly cut the train station, and we adopted this mobile. Okay, and then the food was able to be distributed about the country, and we started with this new supermarket, and the gelée de Mocotó was sold now for the mass again. So that's why all the people that were born about the 70s and 80s, they had this idea of eating Mocotó as something very good for children, etc. Okay, I have to hurry. My God.
Yes, and okay. So we have time for questions.
Okay, and here you have these advertisements of Mocotó jelly. This one is really funny with this little very fat baby. It's very, quite cute, but I mean, and the Mocotó done with this industrial Imbasa and this Dutch company and other companies. And so, okay, here we have types of industrial Mocotó jam. And you see this man with Mocotó is very strong. And all sort of different Mocotó styles, because you can have it this as a very jelly we brought for you to experiment if you like to. And a pasty one. And that one should be one sort of Mocotó done artisan style Mocotó. I will run, okay.
No, I think we have to stop.
Yeah?
We have to stop, because we have to give time for Pelin.
Okay, okay, that's
it. It's awful, isn't it? But that's what this, that's what the symposium is about, because you're being so fabulous.
Okay.
So can we just have, we'll just do 5 minutes of questions so Pelin has time, okay? Anybody, some questions? I mean, I feel like we've stopped in mid-flight, but I want you to have a chance to ask.
I just want to ask that do you have
make it louder so they
do you have a offal shop in Brazil, because you say that there's no good looking towards to the ox feeds or trotters, so you don't have.
No.
Question is, are there offal shops, offal butcheries in?
Not really, not anymore. It's ending, because now we have this a very big industry of meat, and they are selling the cuts. They are kind of a boutique of meats, and they are selling this all with wrapped with plastic, and people think they are buying something very special.
So if I want to buy an oxfeed or trotter,
well, you can find it.
I can find it where?
Well, you can go to butcher shop, but not in the elite areas of the town anymore. So they are kind of going away from the town.
Anybody else? Yes, over there.
That was great, thank you. I just wanted to know, I'm just curious enough to know whether the Mocotó, is it still popular among the generation of new parents? Do they encourage their kids to have Mocotó because it's supposed to be good for your health. And also a second part of the question is that on the Mocotó jelly or the jam, do you have like a nutrition value which says that it's
Yeah, well, okay, the nutrition value is actually nothing because, exactly. I was asking a nutritionist about it, and she said actually the Mocotó is not good value of collagen because it's all probably made out. They have a lot of additions of things there to make taste and flours, and so it's not really very good. We believe it's still sold a lot for popular use, the mass use, but not really, not many people use this. But they don't use this now because of the sugar, actually. Not many people know it's Oxford. Not many people know, because as soon as they get to know, they reject it, you see. So I don't know what's going to happen.
What? One more. Oh, I'm sorry, he was next.
Yes, we spoke on Mocotó in Saint-Paul, the chef Oliveira de
I was going to show that. Can I?
Yes.
Wow, okay,
sure.
I can.
Sure.
Okay, great, okay.
In Brazil?
I was going to show you many things. Okay, this is a very, very famous, here's the guy, Chef Rodrigo and his father. And there is this restaurant, and this is a plate of Mocotó, but the broth, not the jelly. And they opened the restaurant at 1973, and it became really, really famous. And that's why I go back. You see, I brought all this pieces of notice and publications saying how good they are, and so they have this now this sort of brands. They have the restaurant and the cachaçaria, which is cachaça. They made the cachaça, and they have kind of different styles of Mocotó serving. But they serve Mocotó. They're very famous in São Paulo. Yeah.
And Mocotó was very good.
It's quite good.
I can we say thank you. I think you should write a book.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Pelin. I'm coming from Istanbul, Turkey. And actually, I'm a chef, but right now I'm doing my own business in Bodrum. I was born and raised in Istanbul, but then I moved to Bodrum. Do you know where is Bodrum? It's the southwest of Turkey. It's a very touristic area right now. And in there, I'm managing my own small cooking school in there. And I have a degree on gastronomy and culinary art department. And then I went to my master thesis to the cultural studies department to study food culture, and in there I did my master thesis about offal, and with my consultant, with my teacher Özge Samancı, and as far as I know, this Oxford Symposium. Also, Aylin Öneytan, I know you know her very well. She just encouraged me to go to here, and it's just such an honor to be with you in the Oxford Symposium. It's my dream, and it came true, and I'm so excited. And I just want to how it's working.
No. You have to make it up to
5:55. Okay.
Yeah,
yes, this is my family, an old Istanbul family. This photo was dated back early 1950s. My grandfather and grandmother. And now she's looking like that. Still beautiful, isn't she? And I grew up in a family of old Istanbul and began to learn about my food culture through the stories told by my grandfather and grandmother. And offal was one of the leading components of our dinner tables. If nothing else, there will be a pot full of liver and boiling for the cats. We are giving the liver and lungs to the cats also. And but unfortunately, I lost my grandfather one year ago, and I wish that he could watch me in this area. And this is our daily routine, our daily dinner table. You can see our tripe soup. This is a garlic and vinegar sauce for this soup. And this is a lamb's liver. We call it Albanian liver, but I will tell you why we call it Albanian liver. Actually, it's not. And this is also Albanian liver. I will tell you more about it. So the lack of adequate written material about this topic encouraged me in pursuing my research on offal. Then I wrote a thesis that I mentioned before with my food history teacher, Özge Samancı, 3 years ago. And now it is published as a book. And I just brought my book. Although it's in Turkish, you can just maybe pass around and have a look at. There's some pictures on it. And so I just wanted to tell you a bit more about how is my offal research started. When I was desperately seeking a subject for my final project at the gastronomy school, I found myself looking and standing in front of a GRG, a liver shop. GRG means a liver shop in Turkish. And this is the real scene. I was like standing this scene. And I stared at the lungs and livers, the head, the tripe, and remembering my childhood tastes and missing them and realizing that this amazing food culture was quickly disappearing. And at that moment, I chose my path to become an offal advocate and a chef. That is how I started my early 20s, to set an example for young chefs like myself that offal is not offal. So, offal. This is a very early picture of a GRG, liver seller on the street. He's from Albania. I will tell you why. And let's have a look at the word. In Turkish, this word offal is sakatat. So you can see the other words also. The word for offal in Turkish, sakatat, is coming from Arabic, as Sami Zubeyda mentioned yesterday. And it means that it's a useless or fallen parts of every object and the inedible parts of the animal. But however, in Turkish cuisine, offal was never considered as a waste or undesired part. But on the contrary, it was always fed to small children, hopefully giving them strength, as Mocotó does. It is also true that depending on the cultural context, offal might both be considered as a food for the poor or as a delicacy that commands a high price. And this is, yes. Also, I want to add that sakatat is derived from the word sakat, like you can see here. And it is a singular name. Sakat is the singular name. And when we add or put A and T at the end of the word, it gets a plural name. So sakatat means sakats or offals. Okay, I just want to tell you that. So, offal is a foodstuff that has been affected by so many cultural aspects, and it survives to these days, needed by the distinct food culture of each ancient civilization and blended with modern ingredients and traditions. So, the history of Istanbul cuisine. I just want to, it's a very, very huge subject, but I want to tell about a little history of Istanbul cuisine. Because the roots of our traditions, which are a part of our daily life, come from very, very ancient times, from Byzantines, Ottoman, Central Asian Turks, Armenian, Jewish, Balkan, and so on. And this cuisine has been influenced by many cultures. And surely each culture's offal repertory has contributed much to Istanbul cuisine. However, these habits have somehow been forgotten or updated in today's fast changing times, and of course offal is particularly affected. So this is another presentation. So the stages of offal production: the animal, slaughterhouse site, liver shop or GRG, and other markets. This picture is dated back very lately Ottoman period. Also, you can see the cats here. And now it's time to explain more about why we are calling Albanian liver, or they are, why they are Albania. The name of the Albanian liver is not coming from Albania, actually. I mean, there isn't any dish in Albania called this dish. It's a unique taste of Istanbul, actually, because the reason that we named it like that is people who migrated from Albania or other Balkans lands to the Ottoman period, to the Ottoman territory, they started to work in slaughterhouses. And when the slaughterhouses closed down in Sütlüce region, in the European side of Istanbul, they started selling this dish on the streets. So they invented, or let's say they created this dish in Istanbul. So this is the Istanbul dish, the Albanian liver. So, and I just want to add that offal was only sold in liver shops or GRGs, but now from 2000s it started to sell on the other markets, like supermarkets or other places. This is a GRG, the liver shop. You can see the sign is very, very old. And this is another GRG, dated back 1990s. You can see how like rich showcase in here. And those are just photos of, you can see the head. These photos from the 4 a.m. in the morning. And it was so tough for me to take all those bloody pictures. I'm so sorry to showing you those pictures. This is oxtail. We call it poch also. I don't know why, because I don't know the name of poch means. But
the upper side of the hip.
Really?
Yeah.
But it's not. I don't know why. Really? Really? Okay. And you can just see that my GRG, he's just explained this oxtail as a flower. I don't know why, but maybe he's right, because it looked like a flower also. And this is also an ancient picture of the Albanian liver seller. And those trotters, Mocotó. So let's move on. You can see the fat of this tripe fat. It is interesting because it was used in sweet pastry making in Istanbul cuisine. We are just before the margarine thing, you know, the margarine industry. We were using this fat into create some sweet pastries like börek or cookies or something like that. And the trap shops also sell those fats, oils inside of the cans. Yes, my main subject. Yes, I'm using those cookbooks, and also I have I brought an example of one of these. But it's just a paper, it doesn't have any pictures of it, so I just want to show you the cookbooks. The cookbooks are the main sources that we can learn what and how we eat. Also, they lead people to cook at their homes. And I just wanted to study in a comparative manner, because this shows us the changes in preparation methods through the recipes. And when we look at the early cookbooks, we see that offal culture was inherited from Central Asian and Ottoman culinary traditions and was still surviving in the same way in the recipes. And I just want to show you this very big table. And you can see the total recipes from the just a book from Fahri Nedim, let's say 1939. It's from the period of early Republican era, because we are using Turkish alphabet after our Republican era. So you can see the total recipes and the offal recipes. You can just have a look. Both the traditions of cooking offal at homes is slowly dying, as well as the trade of offal butchery. So I just wanted to show you those books has so many amazing recipes, like tirit. Tirit is the name of both the dish and cooking technique, which is prepared with stale bread chunks soaked in broth. It has different versions, either with or without offal, such as tripe, trotter, mincemeat, lamb, or chicken. And it's nowadays it gets a very famous effect in Istanbul cuisine. And in this book of Fahri Nedim, dated back 1928, treat with marrow, trotter, liver, tripe, and various tongue recipes are the remarkable ones among those recipes. Also, it's very, very interesting that we have the Edirne-style tongue recipes comes from the Ottoman period. It is so interesting for us because our Edirne is a city in the very east of the Turkey, and it was famous by its Edirne-style tongue, but now they are just famous about their liver-style dishes. And it was just a good example of that. And this is another book from Ekrem Muhiddin Yen. And this book also a textbook used in the girls' schools. So there are 27 of the recipes in the books. And tripe soups, like tripe with chickpea, European style recipes such as suckling lamb head cooked in parchment paper. You can see how alla franga style or European style dishes that we see in this book, and also Bahri Özdeniz's book. This book is very, very interesting. I brought this book with me. If you want, I can just give and have a look. You can have a look at. This book also has European and Turkish culinary culture mixed with together, and recipes such as trotter treat, trotter palte, a kind of gel dish like Mocotó, and the fried sheep intestines stand out among the other offal recipes. We see that also treat reappears also in this book. And also there is a very, very amazing and interesting recipe of stuffed trotter. It's called paça dolması. 3 years ago, I just applied this symposium about stuffed and wrapped foods with this subject, but now I'm here. Okay. And it's very weird that because you know the trotter is very hard, and the muscles parts of the boiled trotter are cut out before, the remaining and soft meat parts are chopped up and cooked with onions and spices, then stuffed into trotter meat. This dish used to exist in the Ottoman period also. And when we come into 1970s, we see the Necip Ertürk. He's a five-star hotel chef, and he was. He also wrote some very interesting dishes, like you can see, where is the dish name? Oh, Cartlak kebab. Like it's throat kebab. And in Gaziantep region, we have this recipe. And Trakya sweetbread, it's trace, am I right? Trace sweetbread. And also, it is the first time that we came across the sweetbread in the cookbooks. We use sweetbreads, we use oxtails, we use intestines. But it's so weird that in the cookbooks, there's just one recipe of sweetbread, and there's no recipe about spleen and oxtail. It's so weird to me. I don't know why. But yeah, I can explain it a little bit, but I don't know the exactly why. And this book also from Sevim Taner. She's also a teacher of nutrition and home economics. The target group consists of her students, and the recipes like Italian style tripe soup is an example for alla franga recipes, because she's like teaching the students very muchly like alla franga and European style dishes. And also brain soup and brain souffle and brain fritters I just came across firstly in this book in 1985. And am I have time?
You've got about 6 minutes.
Okay then, I'm very sharp, okay. And also Leman Cılızoğlu Er Yılmaz. This book also reflects the decrease of offal recipes in cookbooks, because offal is completely out of the soup. Like, for example, we call tripe soup now in our home dishes as faux tripe soup or yalancı işkembe. And in this recipe, tripe soup is prepared using chicken skin instead of tripe, and named as tripe soup from chicken skin in that book. So it was so interesting for me. And this is also a conclusion. This is the same tables of this here. You can just want to have a look how the total recipes and the offal recipes where I. And now I have good news to you, because yes, we see the big European, especially French effects in those cookbooks. For example, that I mentioned before, brain with souffle, brain with mornay sauce, Italian style tripe soups, deviled kidneys, and canapés with tongue, and so on. And it's very good that now we are using all of this very good offal stuffs. We are now started to using those things as well. And I have also good news to you, because I've just deal with a very big supermarket company. It is not so good that I'm deal with a supermarket company, but they want to protect this tradition, because when we came across to those days, like 212, you can see the total recipes, and you can see there's no offal recipes in the cookbooks. So we have just deal making a new cookbook, and those are the recipes of this new cookbook published. They will be published in soon, very very soon. This is my recipes, because I'm already tell you that I'm a chef. And this is a sauteed lamb's heart, lamb's kidney, and this is a grilled one. Tripe schnitzel, it's very, very delicious. And this is our tripe soup. Also, we have ram's testicles, it's balls. And some tongue with canapé. And yes, thank you very much for listening to me.
So I have some images, and my preamble is this. I'm going to talk a little bit about calapoche. So calapoche is a dish. It means basically head and shank. And there's versions of it found all over the place. Sammy could tell us in way more detail than I can about all the places it's found. It's in Armenia. The Assyrians have it. It's all over the place, and it is a dish of comfort. So that in shops in Azerbaijan, in Iran, you see heads cleaned, prepared, ready to be eaten. And in Turkey, you see heads and shanks, and they're arranged often in a very nice little geometrical, tidy little array, like a sort of architectural construction. So I knew about calapoche. I have never cooked it. And I was in Iran, and I was staying at a farm, which was a sort of tourist place. I mean, I could stay there, like a homestay, in the mountains. And the guy I was staying with said, well, would you like to come up to the mountains tomorrow? And I said, sure. And there's Kamseh nomads up there, which is a, anyway, they're nomads. Some of them speak Arabic. Some of them are Persian speakers. They're a mixture of origins. And now what do I do with this? Somebody? Oh, here it is. I see. And so I, oh, this is, oh, shoot. Okay. It got advanced somehow. How do I go back to the beginning? Because I didn't want
the
her.
Beginning.
I want that one. Yeah, thank you. And then how do I make it big? You need young people for technology. Thank you so much. So I was in Iran and traveling around, and I was first in the north, and here sheep and goats, a herd of sheep and goats in northern Iran. It's a dry country except in this wet part of Iran, and sheep and goats are kind of the mainstay meat. Now what's advanced? No. Okay, this one. Sorry. What's advanced? That one. Okay.
Okay.
Iran's an ancient culture, and so we see evidence of sheep and goats in this wonderful bas-relief, which is part of the ruins in Persepolis. Persepolis is the capital that was built by Darius, largely, perhaps founded by Cyrus BC, and then eventually destroyed by Alexander in his conquest. 519 is the date I have, and destroyed by Alexander in 330 BC, and some remnants remain. So anyway, I was staying in this farm. We went up to the nomads, and in Iran, I was there at the time of the Feast of the Sacrifice, and I know that in Turkey, Kurban is a very big thing, and its animals are killed. It marks the Feast of the Sacrifice, when Abraham was prepared to sacrifice his son, and then at God's order, and then God let him off the hook. And so in Turkey, for example, it's like a combination of Thanksgiving and Christmas in a way, because people kill animals and feed the neighborhood, feed their families. It's a big thing. And I was in Iran, and I thought, oh good, I'm in Iran for Kurban. And but no, in Iran it's not a big deal. The only people who really do the sacrificing in Iran are, I was told by a number of people, are families who have a haji in the family. In other words, somebody who's made the pilgrimage to Mecca. So we drove up these dry hills, up the mountains, to this Kamseh camp. And these nomads move every year. So they were about to leave. They were going to leave a week later. This was in October, to go south to warmer a place near the sea for the winter. And then in the spring, after New Year's in March, they make the 25-day trek with their animals and their children back up into the mountains for the summer. Anyway, we got there, and miraculously, amazingly, there's the tents, one of the tents, and this woman was out, and she lit a fire, and she was working with, it turns out her husband was a haji, and she was working to clean a sheep's head and trotters, because they'd had the sacrifice, the big feast the day before, and she was using the rest, the offal. So what did she have to work with? She had the lungs, she had the head. Mm-hmm. But she, of course, and this is really, these images are a reminder, because I want to touch base about this. We've had mentions in passing about the amount of work involved in processing something as remote to our senses as food, as offal is, to get it from the foot or the head with hair on it to something we're prepared to put into our mouths takes a hell of a lot of work. And so that's why mostly in cities everything is pre-processed and we can buy it. That's how the supermarket's going to sell the offal. But if you're back here, and I'm not lauding tradition, I mean, it's extraordinary, but it's terrible labor. And I'm not wishing that we all were doing this, because it's an incredible amount of work. So she's scraping the head, and I just took loads of pictures. She's cutting it apart. She's singed the hair off already on the fire. She's got the fire going, and she's got the water boiling, and then she's going to pour the water onto her to wash it. And then she's going to scrub like crazy. I mean, she scrubbed and scrubbed. I was taking pictures there for, it was well over half an hour, and she'd started before I arrived. She's scrubbing everything clean. And this is the other thing to remember, that we can be casual, but if the issue is that you don't ever want to waste anything, you are meticulous. You take out every stone out of that rice, and you clean every bit of dirt. This is, you're honoring your family, but you're also making sure that nothing is going to be rejected as unclean or unwashed or, you know. So it is a huge amount of work. So she's still cleaning. She's opened the head out. She's scrubbing away with sort of a rough cloth, and it's actually a piece of, you know, the plastic, woven plastic sacking for rice, bags of rice, the outer one. That's the piece of fabric that she's using to scrub with. A reject to wash a reject. And there she is, close in. And it's just labor, 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 unstopping work. And then with a knife scraping off the bits that she judged not suitable. And there she is. And I just, you'll see portraits of her through this, because I just want us to remember that this is a human being laboring. This is only one of her days, only one of her mornings. She found me just, you know, amusing. I mean, there I was, and, oh, okay. But she still got on with it. I mean, this was not a social occasion. She was working.
How old do you think she was?
How old? I asked her. She was 59. She's a very beautiful woman. And her husband was 63. So there's the teeth, there's the head. It's starting to be, it's been separated. There she is again, just so lovely. And now she's cutting up lung, because it's going to go into the broth as well. And her hands were remarkably unscarred, and actually, although her joints are a bit swollen, in remarkably good shape for a woman who's working so hard. Here she is with her daughter. Again, they're cutting up the lung. Her daughter's having to hold it so that they can cut, they can separate it. Oh, what am I doing here? There, she takes three hands. You hold both sides and then a third hand to cut with. And I just think the tangibleness of this is terribly important, because we've been talking in layers of theory and practice, but the actual labor of it is killer. So now she's got it all in the pot and the lid's on, and it's going to cook. And it's going to cook for a long time. And but she's pleased. She's done the labor, right? And I'm just going to take you for a short walk to some of the neighbors there so you can see, because I had a lot of time. You can see who else was there. So this is the tent structure. They also had a permanent building that was sealed off. But the tent is airy, and this is the neighbor's tent, actually. Really interesting. And these are the things that are the permanent structure. They can lock and go off on their trip for the winter down south. The tents they take with them, of course, and they'll set up down south. So these are guys. See, guys are always lounging. These are guys, and they have tea. Sorry, guys. But true, I mean, she's laughing. It's true, right? And so there they are, hanging out, you know, and drinking tea, and it's in the neighboring tent. And this is the rest of the family in the neighboring tent. These little kids, and there's all their possessions. And I just thought you'd be interested to see. This is on sort of gravel. It's clean and airy. With lounging guys and hardworking women, what can I say? These are the children, and the child, the one in white, taught me how to play a game of jacks. Oh, I don't know if any of you have done it, but it's just with rocks, and you toss the rock up and you catch it before it bounces. Anyway, she was so fast. And this gives you an idea of the structure of the tent on the outside. And there's, you know, all the utensils are hung in different places. So there's the sieve. This is the haji. This is in the permanent structure, because he's having tea because he knows, you know, time has passed, and at some point this calapoche is going to be ready. So we're now assembling in the house. See, there's a gas burner as well, and they've got some money. They've done okay, and they've got one daughter who's married out to somebody in town. And she's with us as well. And so here's three of the other daughters. And this, of course, is a bedding and possession stacked up behind. Everything very orderly. And then here she is. Okay, done. Right. and out she goes. Because when she left the room, I thought, oh, she's going out to get it, and I raced out to catch a picture of her. And here we are. So you can see the teeth still, there's the tongue. Everything's left whole. She didn't cut the tongue up, it just went in, everything went in relatively whole. And then she's dishing it out. We're eating it with bread. We're eating it with flatbreads, and any of you who know me at all know I'm a sort of flatbread obsessive. So anyway, and this is something that they called nanitiri, which is the word that I also heard in Kurdistan, which is interesting. And here's the bowls of broth. So there's not many hard pieces. What we're getting, we've got the essence. It's like chicken broth. We've got the essence. We're not chewing on the teeth. We're not chewing on the bones. We're eating the goodness that's being cooked out of it.
Other ingredients went in besides
water. Some herbs and salt, wild gathered herbs. The daughter from town had come up, and she'd brought rice and chicken because she's bringing them town, right? She's bringing them what she could do. But this is the bowl of, the calapoche with some bread torn into it. Because you tear bread into it to thicken it, and then of course you also dip bread and eat. So you're eating, the bread has got many tool uses and thickening uses, all sorts of uses. So here's the Haji's hands, also remarkably, though thickened, not wrecked by work and labor. We had pickles that also had come from town. Here he is eating a piece of pickle. And here's everybody tear. This is how it works. The bread's there, and you just reach over. And you don't sort of say, oh, you go first. You just, everybody sort of not fighting for it, just sharing it. It's there. And the pomegranates. There we are. And there's, that's the end of the feast. It's always an interesting picture, don't you think? So that's what's left. There's the bones and the jawbone and so on. Fragments of bread. Some of the small fragments of bread will be swept up and used for something else, added to thicken something. The rest of the bread will be wrapped and used for the evening meal. There was a little, and there's some onion over there.
Do
is.
Do they have pets, like dog or?
Not that I saw. They had the animals, and there she is, pleased. You know, we've had our day, and it was really extraordinary. Now, I want it. Also show you a couple of pictures that relate to the things we've seen before. In the Caucasus, because I've been working in the Caucasus as well, doing research, but this is actually in Kerman in southern Iran. So these have been singed, so they've got the smile. Who was it that talked about the smile when it was scorched? Yes, it was you, right. So there it is, and I knew before you explained what you were gonna say because I'd seen these, you know, because when you singe, the skin tightens and so you end up with these smiling heads. This is in the Kerman Bazaar, which is one of the great bazaars of Iran. This is in Azerbaijan, in Sheki, which is towards the Georgian border, and it's in the foothills of the Caucasus, so the mountains rise behind it. And you can't see, this is very dark, but those are cattle, cow legs, and then there's the sheep heads, and there's a big cow, ox nose, you see? Huge, we're talking massive. And finally, because we did have a cat in those pictures. This is in a small town called Lahic. And there's the cat. The butcher is above. He's standing at his thing like this, smiling at me. And below him is the cat and what he has for sale. And the village of Lahic, just to sort of round this out and loop it back to things Persian, the village of Lahic is one of the villages in Azerbaijan which speaks a local language which is Iranic. It's a remnant language that when the Ottomans came through, or when the Turkic language-speaking people came through, there were remnant villages that didn't take up the Turkic language as their first language. And Lahic is one of them. So all the people in the village speak Lahici, and then they go to school and they learn Azeri. And it's a very interesting thing. And the guy I stayed with there, I stayed in a homestay, he said he spoke English and Russian and, you know, all those things that are humbling when you're just an ignorant outsider. He was so great. And he said, you know, people had warned him it'd be really difficult to teach Azeri to his students. But he said, actually, there's so many Iranic words in Azeri, that in fact the students, although it's a different language family, Iranic languages are and Turkic languages, they all make the transition fine in school. Anyway, this is our envoi to offal in the region. Thank you. I don't have this time. So this is my filler. Yes, there's
no,
a little time.
That was brilliant. That
oh, good. I'm glad you like it. Yeah.
For an impromptu.
Yeah. I'll say that. Photos are a very good ending.
Well, it's pretty nice because you had the photograph with the cats, didn't you?
Yes.
Yes. It just I think there are always cats around butcher
yes.
shops, right? Yeah.
Was that in the Republic of Azerbaijan?
This is in this is in the Republic of Azerbaijan, and Lahic is it's west of Baku. You can visualize the Caucasus Mountains. Basically, travel east a bit, southeast. And I had traveled from Baku on the Caspian coast, kind of northwest, about 3 hours to this village. And the homestay, if you're ever going to Azerbaijan or Georgia or Armenia, there's an extraordinary, it's very flexible, not the Azeri visas, but it's very flexible in terms of staying. You can stay in homestays, very affordable, and then you're there and somebody has a kitchen and they're not fussed because you're a foreigner, because they have somebody staying in a room or two. And so you're sort of, you get to be in the swim in normal life. It's not glamorous, it's fabulously unglamorous. You're just right there. And so you can stumble on things that you didn't know existed, which is my idea of heaven. Anybody have any other question? Yes?
Was that bread in baked and stored for a time?
Yeah, she does it. It's the same way as the Kurds did in Halabja, where I stayed in Iraqi Kurdistan. So it's a Saj baked bread.
Yeah.
And so they make a huge stack of it, maybe once a week.
Yeah.
And then it just gets wrapped, and you just can throw some water on. But you don't even need to, because if you're using it, tearing it up, whatever. And then the Armenians, and everybody else too, but the one I know about best, I think, is the Armenian one. Everybody has wonderful ways of using. The Armenians have baked dishes of the fragments of lavash or unleavened bread with layered with a bit of cheese and a bit of onion, and then you pour a little cream on top and you bake it. I mean, what could be bad? So it's really, you know, the it never goes to waste, even though it looks so broken up. Yes? Well, it's interesting. Yeah, it's basically that thing that Charles Perry wrote about it, other people have written about it, that if you have a problem, if you have a leavened dough, the air goes into you've got your holes, and the air goes into it and it can rise, and so you can cook it through evenly with enough moisture to transmit the heat. But if you have an unleavened dough, then you have a problem. You have to cook it thin, because if you cook it thick and unleavened, the heat doesn't go through, there's not enough moisture, there's not enough way for the heat to get transmitted, there's no air in there. So the easiest way to do it is either just make very quickly made, baked only on one side in the saj, they're not flipped over, flatbreads, or if you want to make a sweet, you make a layering of those same thin layers. So these are all, just like strudel is another version of that same solution, which is a layering with some fat in between, so that you have enough moisture that each layer cooks and you don't get a rawness. This is we're into my favorite geek flatbread territory. Yes?
Can you tell me, is the bread at that stage cooked already and then layered with the fat and then recooked?
Oh, no, no, if you're doing that stuff, no, it's everything, it would be raw. I mean, this is like baklava, but also in there's places where the bread is layered as you make it. For example, in Tajikistan, there's a bread and there's katlama, I think it's called, and there's other places they make this equivalent where this is your luxury dough, where you're almost doing like a kuinyaman. You take the dough and you put some fat on it and you roll it up and you flatten it out, and so you end up with a flaky bread. And again, the fat in the layers helps it cook, so it can be unleavened as long as you've made sure that each of your layers, as you roll it out and roll it up and roll it, that are thin enough that the heat can penetrate through, right? Yeah.
The recipe from 150 degrees in Latin in Cato, 4 like that, with ricotta and honey and layered cheese.
Well, you know, it is human ingenuity. There, the kinds of solutions at one level are infinite, at another level they're very finite, and then the infinity comes with the nuances that we put on them. You know.
This is lavash.
Yes, but this, no, the one that they had there, the nomads, was more like yufka. It's unleavened. It was unleavened, and the nanatiri unleavened,
yeah.
And then and that's what I saw with the nomads, and that's sort of true also the Kashgai. They also have the unleavened.
Yeah. No, I was just
Yes.
Especially with the nomads. Exactly,
because it's quick.
Especially the tourist nomads.
Yeah, sure.
And then they come to your house. There are, you know, like, you know, with they have special hanging, how you say, construction.
Yes.
That you stack the bread there.
Yeah.
And wherever you need it, you just sprinkle a bit.
Sprinkle a little water and it softens enough. Yeah.
And there's lots of traditional uses for recipes with the dried bread.
With the dried out bread.
Especially in customary area, it's inland. There's, you know, you wet the flat bread with chicken
broth. Well,
and then layer it with
all those Arab dishes, yeah, fateh dajj and all of that is the same thing, you know.
It's a constructed dish.
Yes, a constructed dish, exactly, but all those fateh dishes.
So it's not recooked. But
no.
With Charles Perry, we saw also in Istanbul a version of a sweet version made of it.
Yes.
So it's like the ancestor of baklava in there.
Sure, exactly.
And it's also in Özge's project, Özge Samarcu's project. I think it's Tante's Kitchen or whatever. Tante's Kitchen. There was an international project. And she documented in the video, it's still in the video, yufka tatlısı, which is made with layers.
Yes.
Dried bread and molasses and walnuts. And
sure.
Layers and butter, and then put it in the oven, so it's like the ancestors of Mandalay.
Yeah, it's just, there's just all these ways, but that's so interesting to know about the one going way back. Thank you for your patience, everybody. Have a good lunch.
Thank you.
Thank you.